And we will start with Professor Sharon Hannes from the Tel Aviv University Law School.
Thank you, Zohar. Our panel is about the decentralization legislation in Israel. It's a major piece of legislation. It has a few parts. One of the significant parts is the one that bans more than two layers for a stock pyramid of public corporations. And I'm not going to speak about the legislation. I will let my two distinguished friends to speak about that. I'm going to speak about one basic assumption that lies at the basis of this legislation, which is that in Israel, it's an assumption or a notion that controlling shareholders, perhaps especially those that have low cash flow rights, like controllers through pyramids, they consume a lot of private benefits of control, and therefore they must be restrained. And if we cannot do that through the courts, through other mechanisms, then we need some structural change that would prevent them from consuming so much private benefits. And so my story, or this assumption, is based on a very famous international empirical paper by Dyke and Zingalas. And they wanted to understand, to compare how much controlling shareholders consume throughout the globe. So they examined 39 large markets and tried to measure the size, the magnitude of private benefits of control. How can we do that? It's not so easy. And they had, they used methodologies that was developed 10 years before them, around 10 years before them by Berkeley and Holdersness, which up till today is considered the best method available to try to measure private benefits of control. And the idea behind this methodology is that what we see every day is not the entire value of the corporation, but rather its public value. That's the market cap of the corporation. You can easily compute that by multiplying the number of issued shares by the price per share. But if you can think about the corporation as an iceberg, there is a piece of it below the water. You don't see it every day. And this is whatever controlling shareholders consume from the corporation. But once every few years, control change hands, and at least in Israel and many other markets, the controlling shareholders must report the value of the shares that were transferred between the hands of the old controlling shareholders and the new controlling shares. And according to that, the price above the market price that the new controller is paying the old controller, you can think about that as the minimal amount of private benefits of control consumed. Because if they are paying for something above the market price, it might be that they are paying for private benefits of control. So here I know Zoe and Asaf has other ideas of what that premium could be for, but I did not invent this methodology, so you can, you don't, that your argument is not with me. Anyway, so they did this international comparison, and they studied 39 markets. And the calculation is very simple. The denominator is simply the amount paid above market price in dollars per this control purchase, and the denominator is the market cap of the company. So the measure is private benefits of control as a percentage of the public value of the corporation. And the results, which are quite dated, were very grim for Israel. Israel has a control premium of 27%, which means that according to this estimate, Israeli controlling shareholders consume about a third of the value of the corporation privately. The global average was 14%, and Israel was part of the worst, quote-unquote, countries with Brazil, Turkey, Venezuela, other markets that have very high control premium. There are other companies that have low control premiums, and those that have very low control premiums also have very large and diffused ownership markets. So when Chief Justice told us that he doesn't think, or no one thinks, that self-dealing is a major problem in the US, there is some data backing that notion. And the data is that control premiums in the US according to Zingales, is around 2%. So the controlling shareholder, when there is a controlling shareholder, is willing to pay not that much for control. But this data is based on nine transactions in the Israeli market between 1990 and 2000. So this is quite old data, between 25 and 15 years ago, and it shows a very ugly picture, if you wish, of the Israeli market. A few years later, Barak and Lauterbach, two Israeli researchers, decided to reiterate this study for the Israeli market. And something significant happened in 2000. The new Israeli corporate code was legislated, went into effect. So maybe it changed anything. And the Dingalas data ended at 2000, so it didn't include the impact of this novel piece of legislation. Barak and Lauterbach has a long period of investigation, and they had 30 in the same methodology that Zingales used, which is the, by and large, the Berkeley and Holderness methodology, which I mentioned earlier. They have 30 transactions. So Zingales had nine transactions in the Israeli market with a control premium of 27 in average. And Lauterbach has a larger sample of 30 transactions. And when they measured the control premium, they didn't find any improvement. To the contrary, there was a small deterioration, if you wish, and control premium was 31%. They had some more elaborated methodology that could flashlight on also on partial control transactions. And when they computed control premiums using their more elaborated methodology, they reached the same result. So things did not get better through time. Nevertheless, since 2005, that's the year of the end of the Lauterbach study, many things happened in Israel. Some of it has to do with legislation, regulation, actions by the court, by the district attorney. I just mentioned a few of the major developments that the Israeli market went through. For instance, I think that a major step happened in the Arad case in the Supreme Court when a controlling shareholder was sent to jail for trying to circumvent the approval requirements of a self-dealing transaction. This was not the last time that the controlling shareholder went to jail in Israel for that crime, but that was, a court decision with it's not only the symbolic act, but also interpretation of the rule of self-dealing. Then another important step was the Goshen Committee. It was nominated by then chairman of the ISA, the Israeli Securities Authority, and the Goshen Committee shed light on the problems of Israeli corporate governance, offered some major modifications. Some of them later were translated to legislation. There was a major piece of legislation led by Goshen when he was the chairman of the ISA. It's called Amendment Number 16 of the Corporate Code. This is the amendment that required the majority of the minority and many other steps that were supposed to make it harder to conduct harmful self-dealing transactions. Then another step that was promoted in the Goshen Committee report was the establishment of the Economic Court. And it's not only the establishment, of course, but also many important decisions by the economic courts that presumably makes it harder for controlling shareholders to consume private benefits of control, at least of the harmful type. Amendment number 20 dealt with executive pay. And finally, after all these major steps, there was this legislation of decentralization that this panel is supposed to deal with. And I want to show you that the data that I showed you about the Israeli market is not something that only academics in Israel and abroad dealt with. This is something that influenced Israeli legislation and regulation throughout this period. I will do that briefly. So I'm quoting Goshen twice. First, he says, he said in a lecture, our goal is to get closer to the American model and decrease the private benefits. This pie that is called the control premium is what we want to take. And then again, the goal of monitoring by the securities authority is to decrease the control premiums. This was a major aim of this regulation, and they use the data that I showed you to show that the problem exists. And then in 2013, there was this new legislation that based itself explicitly also again on this data, which was became quite old in 2013, and also you know, something happened along the way, but no one took the time to check again what's going on before we are trying to correct the situation. So what I did with a friend, I tried to just use the same methodology of Zingales and Dyke, which is the same methodology of Berkeley and Holderness from the 1980s, and I tried to measure control premium in the Israeli market for a newer set of companies. And we covered all years starting from 2006 until today. Actually, it includes 2014 data as well. So 2006 is both the year, the first year after the Lauterbach studies that we know the results of. And it's also the year after the Arad case in the Supreme Court that I mentioned as a major step. And so far, we are still working on it, but so far, I can report the results of all companies that are part of so-called Tel Aviv Stock Exchange Composite, which are all significant companies in Tel Aviv. So the ones that are not in our study yet, they will be, are small companies generally below 75 million shekels in market cap. So those are nonsense, but we have many of them. So we cover around 220 companies, all the large significant companies on the Israeli stock exchange. And what are the results? Those are the transactions. Some of you might not be able to read it, but it involves both relatively minuscule companies are not here. Some of them are smaller transactions. Some of them are major transactions, like the purchase of Migdal, the largest insurer, or Bezek, which is the largest telecommunication company. So we have large transactions and medium-sized transactions. And the results so far, I think, are quite stunning. We see that control premiums dropped sharply. A word of caution, when we add in the other 250 companies, the smaller companies, I expect this number to rise, but still I think this finding is already telling. Control premium, the average is 4.61 instead of 31 or 27. And if we make an average, weighted average according to firm size, market value, then control premium is 1.18. This is reflecting actually the amount that the controlling shareholders of all companies consume from the market, if our average is representative of the entire market. So only 1% on average of market value goes to the hand of controlling shareholders. So this is a very low amount. So if we think about 5%, this is also a relatively small amount, not as good as the US and the UK, but much better than it was earlier. You can look at the distribution of premiums, and you can see that the worst transactions is actually lower than the average transaction that was reported by the previous studies. So even if you think that our transactions, you know, by chance, they do not represent the market, you can see this distribution and see that we actually have no transaction that is above the average of the previous studies. So trends in Israeli control premium, as we can know it so far, so it was the 27 in the 1990s, which everyone sites and the decentralization committee cites that data as promoting its goals. And in 1993 to 2005, control premium went up to 31%, and now in this interim study, around 5%. What are the conclusions? Okay, so we saw this decrease, and what will happen next? Does it mean that at some point we'll face a move towards the diffuse ownership? Perhaps we have some, perhaps first signals of this move. It's too early to know. Should we reconsider the reforms that were already done or that is still proposed aimed at controlling shareholders? And we should note that the decentralization committee relayed on outdated data. What will happen further? Do we have to adjust our laws to welcome the flow of diffused ownership firms? Well, I think there is time to consider that. Thank you.